So we're going to invite three more people up to the stage. So please welcome our first panelist, Jay Ballmer. He's the CEO of Session Games, which is a video gaming company. Roham Gargoslu, co-founder of Axiom Zen, a leading innovation lab in Vancouver, BC, and California. Muriel Dehan, head of digital and managing director of Penseo, web video content, social media. And of course, Craig and myself. I think I'll have a seat now. That was so cool. I love the IKEA graphic there, having a Swedish husband. So I never have that problem. So that's pretty
cool. You're lucky. I suck at it.
Yeah. Well, it was so great hearing about your 28 federations and, you know, all the work you do. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. You certainly had a
powerful impact throughout the world in this area. So, we're just going to just throw it out to you guys first. What do you think about the impact that's happening right now in sports in this area?
Well, I think I couldn't agree more with what has been said. I mean, I think it's a great platform. It's not always used correctly. So people really need to stop and think sometimes. I mean, people love rushing into things. We get a lot of clients saying, oh, we need to just push this out right now. And then we're saying, you know, maybe they don't want to hear about, you know, what your administration or even sometimes your CEO has to say. Maybe actually we should really think fan first. And that's not often the case. So I think it's good that people get excited, but they need to be careful what they get excited about.
Can we keep up with this changing landscape, Ron?
The changing landscape, I mean, keeping up with technology is almost an oxymoron, right? Like when we talk about tech, we briefly touched on this in the session before. What really is technology? At each generation, there's new things that happen. There's things that people don't understand. And often people call that technology. But to me, you know, being a part of a tech firm, there's a lot of the things we're talking about today aren't really that risky. They're not really that uncertain. They're pretty well understood. They're very clear. And if you're not doing them, it's not really technology. It's just good marketing in a certain way, right? Like, and we can dive into it later. So, I mean, keeping up with technology, I think I agree with being strategic, but I think there's a place for experimentation, prototyping, kind of working on smaller communities and, you know, not blasting everything out to everybody, but taking a kind of startup type prototype approach. So, happy to talk about that later as well.
Cool. Jay?
I come from a different perspective, looking at from games as the platform that we're working with to promote brands. And I think the technology piece is don't chase and don't end up too far ahead. The concerns about VR are, is that the next 3D TV where you have a nice experience? Well, that was cool. It'll have some applications, absolutely. And mixed reality will be exciting, but it's not here yet. And it's going to take a while. And you can chase it to make a good news story. That's a good buzz because people are talking about it. I kind of feel that way about esports. It's a good buzz and is exciting, but I don't think everybody should chase it. It's really just keep up, but I don't get too far ahead because you might get in trouble.
So let's talk now. I mean, there's a lot of international federations here. How's sport doing at this level?
I think it varies. I think the hardest thing about sport, and we run into this all the time, is that there's an unbelievable appetite for people to work in sports, right? So you get an overload of resumes, you end up paying under market average. And you also don't get a lot of resources, right? Because I think people don't realize how woefully understaffed sports is compared to other disciplines. And you have these really large, passionate communities of fans, and you don't have the business justification to hire a lot of people to service that audience.
Yep.
So I think sports is tired. If you want to know the truth, I think a lot of people that work in digital in this sector work really, really long hours, and they have a hard time keeping up with.
So they're physically tired. Not the content's not tired.
No, just the people.
But
the people are tired.
Okay.
It's a tough job, and you know, getting more senior people to work in sports is tough to lure them from other industries because normally they do have to take a pay cut. To be frank.
Do you see that?
Yeah, I think it also has to do with the administration sometimes. I mean, I think it's taken a few years for some, you know, there's a wide variety within the international federation. Some are medium-sized, small, large. And sometimes for some of them, it's taken a few years to kind of catch up with also in terms of budget. Instead of allocating to really classic media and to TV and really trying to start to shift that budget a little bit into digital. And some are still fighting that battle. And I think that's partially also why the digital teams are often understaffed and under-resourced, just because they have these ideas, they want to do it, but they don't understand that, you know, to run a Facebook page correctly, it actually takes a whole lot of time. People say, you know, can we just have the intern like post a few things? And we say, no, that's not at all a good idea. So people underestimate it a lot, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, frankly, I'm going to be direct, and I'm going to say sports is not doing well at all. And I like that you put Facebook and YouTube next to each other. And if you think about it, sports has been creating some of the best content in the world since the beginning of time, right? Like, since the beginning of time, sports has been all about chronicling human achievement.
Yep.
And yet, you look on YouTube, and what are the most popular videos, right? They're cat videos. They're homemade, funny jokes and things. And that's partially the responsibility of the federations and of the sporting organizations for holding on to this data and these content rights so tightly. There are established models out there for monetizing content without, giving it away for free all the time. But if you think about it, most of the content ever generated in the history of sports is on tape, right? Locked in kind of media organizations, and nobody's looking at it, right? And there's no way to resurface that at the right time. So, I mean, minor plug that we're working on a project to help make that a little bit easier. But I think there's a lot of room for improvement.
Mm-hmm. Jay, you're nodding over
there? I
think
there's stories at kind of both ends. A lot of kind of the sport level here that talks about some of the sponsorship, and you're really trying to promote brands through sport, and that really becomes the primary goal, and that can kind of take over, especially when you're looking at kind of elite athletes as opposed to the foundations of a sport. And I've seen some incredible stories about how sports are built because now they can find each other.
Yeah.
In my personal hobby being skateboarding, the fastest growth group is actually women, because they're finding each other, they're forming communities, and they're getting together. They're just not sitting back and using it to watch a video or watch a competition. They're using it as a tool to organize themselves, and it's really a success story.
Well, there's a lot of success there, particularly in women in sport. We got one of the icons here, Donna DeVerona, who started a lot of that. And I mean, we were talking about that, yesterday, about how technology now is really helping to elevate women in sport, right?
Well, I need to talk to you afterwards. I have two daughters,
yeah.
So I'm unbelievably passionate about women in sports, and I'm on the digital advisory board of the WTA because women's tennis draws bigger ratings than men's tennis, but the women get paid a lot less. So I think ultimately, if you look at the way that you can create and promote a sport on digital, it makes some of the sports that you wouldn't think rise to the top. The best sport in digital, in my opinion, hands down, is the World Surfing League. Because not only are they innovative, but it's such a beautiful sport to capture.
Is anybody from the World Surfing League here? Has it just got the major plug?
I haven't seen them.
You haven't seen them.
But you had a great analogy earlier that you can't say, coming up tomorrow at 7 a.m. is the perfect waves to watch this surfing competition. Waves happen when waves happen. The biggest surfing competition in the world is called the Eddy in North Shore in Hawaii, and it happens once every 20 years or so, whenever the waves are magical enough. And it's 24-hour notice, and all the best surfers from the world fly in. But the ability to not think linearly, like, I need to do this for a broadcast, but to think, whenever there's good waves, we're going to capture it, and we're going to put that content out whenever we want to. It's just, that's the way that digital content should be consumed.
So that happens organically, of course. But let's get back to some of the foundational things that sport has to have to be relevant. Let's talk with you, Ariel, on that piece.
So you mean in terms of being relevant in digital?
Well, yeah.
The problem is content, and I think that was a good point in terms of the media rights. So a lot of the federations are struggling to actually share their most important content because, well, they have great archives, and they're sitting there either in hard disks or even on tapes that aren't digitalized, or they're being broadcasted by TV, and then again, they're kind of locked up. So I think that's a big challenge for sport, because they can share content, but they often can't share their greatest material for different reasons. So it's resources and it's locked down, but it's really challenging. And I mean, a lot of sports have gone to even, storytelling through little Facebook videos where they really are forced to share pictures and text, and the fans react to it because at least there, they're really talking about something current that's ongoing, a current event, and they can really give some little insights.
Yeah.
But yeah, as soon as they have to share, just a bit of like empty content in it, there's no success there.
So tell me content, that word, because we hear it a lot. So tell me some specifics about what is good content versus bad, or what happens?
Well, good content resonates with the fan, really. So it really hits the mark, and it makes people talk about it. It makes gets people excited about something. And the
is it an action that happens in the sport? Is it about a story about an athlete? I mean,
well,
tell me.
Well, it really depends on the moment. It needs to be on the right time to the right audience, right? Because sometimes we get federations that want to talk about what their president has done or what their board has done, and we say, yeah, but this is a very high-level political decision. Do your fans really care about it? It doesn't mean it doesn't matter, but maybe it's for LinkedIn. Maybe it's not for Facebook. So on Facebook, we really need to think about who are your fans, and we need to respect the fan as well. So you really need to say, can we give them an insight? Can we bring value to their experience? You know, maybe they want a little bit more than just a picture. Maybe they want some key game stats. Let's try to give them a second screen experience. So if they're not watching the stream or if they are watching the stream, what can we do to add to that experience in that moment? So really trying to bring just a little bit of extra.
Yeah, some oomph to it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Want to add to that, Ron, about the content piece? Some foundational things that...
Yeah, I mean, the content is super important. I mean, we were talking about technology, and when I think about impact of technology in sports, I think about it in three different categories. One is on the players and the play itself, and we've talked about, you know, different tracks and wearables and things like that, biometrics. One is on the watching, the viewing experience, the audience, and whether in the stadium or at home. And that's really what we're talking about in terms of the content here. Mm-hmm. The third is obviously the international federations, the stadiums, the team owners, all these things. And I think technology can help you guys better manage your businesses as well as reach the audience more effectively. In terms of content, I think when you're thinking about technology, and the application to audiences, we're talking about accessibility and personalization. So accessibility has been hit on a lot here. Mobile, you know, most users today, younger folks, are not watching television. So to reach them, you need to go to new devices. But personalization is equally important. When you're talking about, you know, putting out little pieces of content here and there, second screen experience, you got to know what I'm watching to target me, right? You got to know what I care about to be able to say, well, this piece of content is relevant. This person wants to see a longer piece of content. This person wants to see a shorter piece of content. All these things. So I think timing is equally important, mm-hmm. to actually the content of the message.
We got a lot of numbers that you put up there. You work with numbers every day in terms of all the millions that are watching, you know, those video games that you're producing. But is it always about those eyeballs that are watching, or is there something more behind all those numbers?
It's about engagement. And for me, kind of looking back, like, not focusing on the content, but how do I appreciate the sport and really become passionate about it? As a Canadian, I grew up watching hockey, went to many games, but I understood it more deeply because I wasn't the right guy to be out there on the ice throwing checks. It wasn't my thing. But I understood it more deeply after playing the video game. Missing a check, getting offside, making those mistakes made me appreciate the sport so much more than I got just from watching it or even hearing stories and commentary. And the interesting thing that came up yesterday was that 1 in 2 is 50% of FIFA players in the US started playing the game, and that's where they got inspired about it. So it's there's content and there's stories, but there's, do I appreciate the drama? And I might follow a professional, but do I know when he made a mistake? Do I know how to watch what's happening on the ice and go, he's open? You know, as opposed to just where the camera's tracking. And so I find I get a deep engagement just because I sort of experienced it virtually.
I would say to us, data is about growth and momentum, because everyone in this room ultimately has a sponsorship objective and a revenue objective for their business. So you need to be able to tell a good digital data story, right? You may be really good on one platform and really crap on another, but what we like to do for our clients is build up the best possible story of where they excel in digital and help them monetize that. Because the moment that you build that momentum and that story and you're making money, you can invest in more people and more resources, and you can broaden your digital opportunities.
So give me an example of how someone would monetize at this level.
Well, I think, you know, a lot of people think about content as just the event itself, right? So track and field, I mean, you're a great track and field athlete. It's not just the 400, the 800 meter final where you get that medal and you're on the podium. It's between events, right? There's a lot that goes into being an Olympic athlete. Those stories need to be told. Those stories aren't owned by any larger broadcaster or any organization. Mm-hmm. I've always been amazed Real Madrid's a great example. The insatiable appetite for training footage, to see what they're cooking in the kitchen, to understand how the guys train. This content performs every bit as well as that one moment when you're blasting across the finish line.
No kidding. Well, that's amazing.
So I think people should really take the time to look at what stories can they tell, and don't be afraid to be raw. Like Snapchat, Instagram stories, these are raw moments. I think there's always a natural tendency for everyone to want to control the message. We don't live in a world where everybody wants totally controlled content anymore.
Yeah, it shouldn't feel too rehearsed. That's really the key.
More spontaneous.
Yeah, we say raw to our clients all the time because that's what people like. So we also try to get fans to send in some content, for example. And when we share that, you know, these are amateur videos taken on phones, but we like to compile them into little clips and, you know, push them out through Facebook for hockey, for example. And it's some of their most successful videos. I mean, last year, the International Hockey Federation shared a video of someone training, you know, playing around on the field with the dog, and he was chasing the ball. This had a huge hit, and you know, because it was just a very friendly, very, you know, different way of approaching the sport. I mean, you need a good balance between very, you know, very informed, very event-focused content, and some more, you know, some bit of airy, fun content as well.
Sorry, one thing. I have a real-time case study that I totally forgot. Do you ever, anyone in here heard of Dugout?
Dugout.
It's a new social media network for football. So we do all their strategy, and we launched a series. They pay money to all these players and all these teams around the world, and they get content. We launched a series called Tiny Talk, which we shot at Liverpool and Everton, and we had kids talking about, in front of their dads, what would your dad do if you became a Liverpool fan? It outperformed. It was top 8 of 10 pieces of content across every platform. It has nothing to do with the team, nothing to do with the players. It was all about kids. I always say kids and puppies. Whenever you need something. Kids, puppies, and cats.
Yeah.
And keep trying new stuff as well. So we always say, you know, it's a bit like of getting to know your audience, and it's not something where you get to know your audience, then you know them, and that's it. It's an ongoing story, and your audience develops, and they change their mind, and they want to see new things. So keep innovating and just, you know, try things from a different angle, shake it up a little bit, because, yeah, if you snooze, you lose. I mean, it keeps changing. So.
And some things may or may not translate from language or culture.
Exactly.
So there's
a
flexibilities to those types of things too, particularly languages and culture. You know, a joke in Canada may not be the same in
Absolutely.
Other parts of the world. So.
Yeah, we really encourage like targeting specific geographical zones as well, because you know people, they want to hear about all the other teams, but at the end of the day, they really want to hear most about maybe their national team, their story as well, and they want to see the sport also being approached a little bit from their perspective. So absolutely.
Rohan?
I mean, I think when you talk about perspective and sending the same message but really reaching different kinds of people, the best case study is the U.S. election. If you look at what Cambridge Analytica, no, I'm serious, if you look at what Cambridge Analytica did with the Trump campaign, it's very, very effective, and they essentially create psychographic profiles, and which you all should be doing of your fans, on understanding, why is my fan my fan? Do they like my athletes? Are they a hero, kind of the hero worship kind of persona? Do they come because they like the traditionality of the sport? My dad did this, my great-grandpa, we all watched it as a family when we were young. Different messages appeal to different kinds of people. Mm-hmm. And I think the power of these modern technology, these modern platforms, is that you can actually target and reach different people with different messages. So it's I mean, when you talk about kind of that style content, I'm sure there are a lot of purists who actually, you know, follow a sport because they care very much about the sport itself, right? And what, you know, what record was broken, what statistics are going on. Whereas there are a lot of casual viewers who are like, what the hell are you even talking about?
Yeah.
Right? What is that? What are you telling me? So I think it's really important to leverage the advances in quote unquote technology. And really it's just marketing. I mean, these tools are out there. We can use them very easily to make sure your message is resonating with your audience and creating the outcome that you want. I mean, digital strategy is absolutely the obviously most of sports today is run through sponsorship and kind of broadcast revenues and things like that. But you guys are managing very powerful brands, right? At the end of the day, it's very difficult to create the kind of brand loyalty that sports inspires. And I think it's not necessarily like, you shouldn't automatically assume that selling that brand loyalty to the highest bidder is the only avenue for monetization, right? Saying that, hey, we've got a bunch of fans, and we're going to say, I have $5, $6. Like, that's not necessarily the only approach to monetization. So I think, you know, we're entering a new phase in which the potential is there to kind of rethink certain assumptions in the sport, and then that's what that's what I think is really fun about it.
Mm, that's really cool. Jay, how could technology...
I think I skipped on your data question you kind of threw at me last time because I sort of had another topic.
Okay, but go for it.
We're fairly obsessed with data in games, especially mobile games. Mm-hmm. We see every little activity somebody does and where they fall off, where they lose interest, and what types of players that we have. So Red Bull Air Race is my kind of case study, I think, here. They wanted a game to promote the Red Bull Air Race as they're sort of bringing the sport back. Mm-hmm. And they needed to promote the rules so fans could understand it. They needed to promote the pilots. And so people got to know the heroes they should be following and caring about. And what happens with a mobile game is it's something you do every day, where games are probably second after social media, I believe, or kind of 15 to 20% of time people spend. But they come every day. They'll spend 15 minutes coming in multiple times a day. We actually try to keep their sessions short as opposed to long, because we want them to come back multiple times. And if we can keep them kind of wanting more, then they keep coming back a few times. And we can have some brag numbers. There's always the big numbers of how many downloads you've had. But then you're really looking for is the what percentage are your permanent fans? And we kind of call it like, what's your terminal number that just they stop? So right now we kind of see people playing almost every day for up to 2 years, and that's about 10% of players become your permanent fans. So we kind of look at, yeah, great. You could say one game got 10 million installs and 10 million people experienced that thing, but how many of them actually stayed and became true fans? And can you use them to get them to watch the sport and follow it and send them a little note in their pocket to say, hey, it's on. You can watch it now on Red Bull TV.
But you're not making a dollar out of those 10 million fans, right?
I mean, well, you're selling a can of soda or energy.
Games are games.
Well, we do.
Quantifying it.
The interesting part is that we own the whole package. Mm-hmm. So the advertising that's shown, the brands and sponsors that are involved, we about 50% is currently coming from sponsors and brands as far as revenue in the games. And then the other 50% is from those long-term players. And only about 2% of them decide to spend money, but that's half our income.
Yeah.
So we're not really looking for revenue from players. That's almost a bonus as sponsors and brands see this opportunity. And so even that guy just who downloaded it, spent 10 minutes in it one day and never came back, there's brand value there.
Of course there is, but not every federation here. I mean, some certainly do. And like, again, going back to the monetization and the simple things that they can do, that'll probably escalate to something like that or, you know,
yeah, I need to answer that for you, but let me just say one thing.
Sure.
Red Bull Media House was started because Red Bull needed to justify having the highest price point for an energy drink.
There you go. Yeah.
So it's the greatest marketing idea in history.
It's like build it and they will come.
Just make great content, make your highest price point energy drink more aspirational. It's worked unbelievably well.
Hmm. Yeah, they don't sponsor, they create.
No, they create. And their content is just as good as any other content. In fact, better in many cases. Yeah. But to answer your question, I think it's really about... we call them content franchises, is what can you package to offer to your sponsors? So is it training during the week? Is it, for Liverpool, we do Match in 60 Seconds, which is just an audio of the radio broadcast that the club owns. It's really taking a lot of the assets that aren't owned by the broadcasters or sold out as rights and being able to package those, understand what they do on a consistent basis and just repeat them. And understand what the digital value is for all those assets. So we do that for all of our clients. Mm-hmm. It's hard for me to say. I would have to think about it sport by sport.
Yeah. Yeah.
But generally, we talk about what happens after match day, the moments that aren't happening from the 2 hours that the broadcaster owns that window. In some cases, like we work in the Indian Premier League a lot. The Indian Premier League, the league owns the entire day. They own pregame warm-up. They own post-game press conferences. So then all you have to do is, okay, well, we have to work with everything that doesn't happen on match day. So I think the hard part is the first thing you need to do is understand, like, what do you have the rights to do? And, I'll say this, but a lot of times we'll look at what leagues or governing bodies haven't not allowed yet, and we'll play in that space and try to get grandfathered.
Be creative. Yeah.
If there's no rules
really
on podcasting or augmented reality or virtual reality, get there first, play around, and try to get grandfathered in. when they
you
say we're going to.
You heard it here first, folks. Get there. Run now.
But get
after
there.
This, everyone's going to know. So run now.
We'll get there first in a way that you can justify and make sense. We talked earlier, only 6.3 million headsets are sold. Don't go telling your CEO that we're going to make a fortune on virtual reality. Yeah. Just say, hey, I think there's a space we can play in if we have a sponsor that's more experimental that we may be able to generate a little bit of incremental. It's all expectation setting.
Absolutely.
Real? I just want to make a minor comment on VR. There's 6.3 million, not a ton, honestly, probably more than it should be given the state of the content that's actually out there right now. But all things look basically like they're not going to happen until they look inevitable, right? So I mean, if you think about the smartphones, I'm barely old enough to remember, but you know, we had the PDAs and the Cassiopeias and the styluses and all that stuff. And a month after the iPhone came out, everyone's like, oh, this is the way it's always been. And that's not true, right? So VR today very much reminds me of that exact same time. And you know, you can kind of argue about what the impact of VR would be, but in games, in sports, in entertainment, that is VR world. Like, there's no, and I agree, you shouldn't be deploying millions and millions of dollars, putting all your budget in VR. There's no point. But to also ignore it is also not the wisest choice. But the point about games, though, I mean, that's one of the few things on mobile that's easily monetized, right? Like, you look at the top 100 grossing apps, and a lot of those, most of those are games. And the unfortunate part is that it's very difficult to drive traffic to games. But that's where you have to do user acquisition, right? But that's where working with celebrities, working with existing brands, and I think sports are part of that, really helps a lot. I mean, one of our partners is one of the world's largest talent agencies, and so we're working with them to see, you know, how do we let them monetize not just monetize as in, again, sell to the highest bidder, but how to build a business around an athlete, how to build a business around a sports team or a particular, honestly, around a community. Like, it doesn't matter whether it's a sports team.
It's a community of sports athletes.
It's just a community.
Yeah, it's a community. Yeah, we got to get back to that.
I want to jump in a little on the VR as another piece. We look at the headsets because we have kind of a perspective of what do we do at home. Yeah. And there's another perspective. We've had some discussions with net cafes in Asia. And net cafes, we don't have the experience of going to a cafe and renting a computer and playing games for hours. That was something that fit for them. They couldn't buy consoles. And playing at home wasn't sort of a supported thing. So they went out. And going out is part of the entertainment. Yeah. And this is sort of a simple view. Mm-hmm. There's 100,000 net cafes within one network in China. And in comparison, there's, I believe, 39,000 McDonald's worldwide. What they are looking at is those net cafes evolving into being VR cafes. Mm-hmm. And so it's a destination experience. It's an out-of-home piece of entertainment. So it's not something you own, but it's something you go and do. Hmm. And it's a huge opportunity, but if you see it from that perspective.
Now, let's turn the corner a little bit. Okay, we talked about some of the things happening now, and, you know, a lot of these are friendly things and great opportunities. So let's turn now to some of the threats to all this, right? It's no secret that cyber has been a really big threat in the news every day. Athletes' information getting breached. I mean, there's so much going on in this area. And so how do we protect sport from this? How do we protect athletes?
I'm not a cybersecurity expert, so.
But, you know, but you have a lot of information. I mean, a lot of the fan information, a lot of information that goes on. And so there's some natural stuff. But we can start with Rahman and maybe
You have good stories in this.
I mean, there's obviously, again, multiple angles, right? You can go top to bottom. There's huge opportunities unlocked by technology. Say, you know, you're using drones for new camera angles, et cetera, et cetera. But the flip side of that is, what if someone hacks into those drones, takes control of your actual hardware assets inside the stadium? There's personalization, reaching the right customer, understanding your fan base, creating psychographic profiles. What if someone hacks into your account and all that data that your fans shared with you is now public on the internet? That trust is breached, right? You're responsible for a brand, you're responsible for a community, and it's important to maintain that trust with the user. I know a little bit about what American sports are doing to because they often are in charge of the stadium itself, right? And when you have to protect kind of not just data but also physical assets, and you know, soon all your stadiums will be hooked up with sensors, all your stadiums will be, you know, fully kind of aware of everything that's going on inside of them, and all that data, all that is accessible to the public. So how do you protect against that? I mean, hire a really good CIO, hire a really good security consultant. I don't think there's any point for federations and teams to build a lot of that competence in-house? I know the top baseball teams all have really good security experts in place, but the threat is multidimensional, and I think it's really not just security, and privacy is a huge component as well.
Mira, is that something some of your clients are looking at right now?
I think it's definitely a two-faced coin, right? Because there's a lot of opportunities and a lot of really nice things that come out of technology. But so absolutely, it's a friend. But you always have to be afraid of the other side, right? So there will always be this little edge of danger where you just need to think about, okay, what are the risks of this project? Even when you're doing a social media campaign, yeah. You know, you want to avoid a certain lashback. People have made mistakes in the past. I mean, I think we all heard about the Ask JP Morgan, you know, hashtag that then trended, and people started to hashtag, why can I have my house back? Hashtag Ask JP Morgan, because, you know, things got really ugly really fast. And I mean, that's different from actual cybersecurity, but
it's very important.
It's still a risk factor. Mm-hmm. So, and yeah, when it comes to the cryptography side of things, I think you just need to make sure things are secure. I mean, we've come to clients that, you know, that we were developing a website for, and they said, you know, our old website had this great thing. They had an Excel sheet, and we could see all our users and all their passwords. And they could just call us and they could say, what is my password? And we said, look, there's a reason that we don't do this. It's very basic, but it needs to be encrypted. So, you know, I think...
Basic stuff.
Yeah, it's basic stuff, but that already helps a great deal, because sometimes even the foundations aren't covered, and then you're just at a great danger.
An international federation that will remain unnamed that we worked with is that same thing.
Wow. Yeah. So. Cybersecurity there for you?
I would say your data is not private, and I'll give an example. Did any of you see the story about Real Madrid and Barca racing to 100 million on Facebook?
Yeah.
So I slept probably 3 hours and 72 hours working on that campaign. We were down by 1.9 million, and Barca was at like 99.2, and and everyone's like, how'd you do that? Well, a lot of the way we did that was through lookalike audiences that are free on Facebook. Mm-hmm. So we know everyone that's a Ronaldo fan. We can target them. We know everyone that's a David Beckham fan, Rafa Nadal, Julio Iglesias. Everyone that we organically got involved in that campaign, their data is freely accessible through lookalike
on Facebook.
Know
where you are, what you're doing, how old you are.
But there's a big difference. There's a big difference between that and knowing that, hey, Craig is at a game in Cincinnati right now and his house is empty.
That's right.
Right? Yeah. Like, that's the difference.
Absolutely.
He might have just posted that, so he voluntarily
right.
said,
hey, oh, that's right. Hey, go to my house.
Exactly. No,
exactly.
Something
I'll tell you where you are.
I'm traveling. I'm here. Am I home? Somebody's really targeting me.
But a lot of things that we think are free are not free. When you're using free Wi-Fi somewhere, you have to log in with Facebook. Yeah. It's not free. You're paying them with your data. You're giving them data of where you are. And even Facebook, you know, people think it's a free app. It is, but you're paying them back.
Yeah. You're the product.
Fair and square.
Exactly. Yeah. You are the product.
Interesting. It's kind of a strange anecdote that when we put out a paid game, 60% of people that logged into our server actually hadn't paid for it. So the game had been hacked because it was paid and somebody didn't want to pay for it. Wow. Our free games, yes, some people hack them, kind of for sport, kind of for fun. But now the numbers are 3% of people who show up on our server mm-hmm. came from someplace else. So giving it away for free and saying, here it is, kind of said, well, there's nothing to steal here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But we have to monitor if they can like break in and find a way to like win the tournament and sort of cheat in the digital world. It's very possible. And then is that a concern? If we're giving away a real prize, yeah, that's a concern. Or is the guy who somehow cheated and got the fastest plane, is he now the guy everyone else is chasing and other people mm-hmm. start spending money to chase him?
Yeah.
There's kind of an interesting journey, and sometimes hacking's okay.
If it's part of the game, it's
set it here first.
It works in our business.
Just one, I recommended people get security consultants. So your comment kind of reminded me to qualify my recommendation.
Cybersecurity.
Yeah, don't trust any security consultant that says they're going to secure your system and it's going to be impenetrable, et cetera. So hacks will absolutely happen. People will be inside your systems. And what you have to find is you need a security strategy that assumes breaches will occur and that kind of protects compartmentalized information and, you know, is able to catch intruders rather than trying to keep them out. You can't keep them out.
They're there. There's just how many.
Exactly.
It's a matter of time. It's just when. So we're going into the future here. Now let's take a step back a little bit in the past, because, you know, we do live in, the whole universality of sport is very important. Some of the small sport, the smaller federations, smaller countries, you know, and emerging markets still in sports and access to this. So how are we going to, you know, embrace all these new technical things that are happening in innovation and sport, but yet have a balance with universality so everyone feels they have access to it? So how do we address that? Who wants to start? Go for it, Craig.
All right. I think you just have to tell your story. I mean, we live in an era of storytelling. And I think the first thing you need to know is, what is your story? How can I tell that story? And once you tell that story, then you figure out how it fits in every medium that we have in the modern world. Every sport is compelling. Every athlete trains really hard to be successful in what they do. I think it boils down to that. And it's been that way since the beginning of time. You know, TV tells its storyline in the way that it does. But we all need, everyone that works for a federation just should always be thinking about their story.
And they're growing their sports in all over the world, you know, over 200 countries in some cases. So you gave me an example earlier about traditional sports still, you know, rising and being relevant without a lot of gadgets around it. So maybe you could share that insight for me.
I don't know
about
if I recall
the surfing, you're talking about surfing.
Oh, yeah, there was a surfing.
And about roller derby and things
like that. Yeah, well, seeing that sports now that are not mass populations in one place gathering together, and is there a way to get into it? So women's roller sport is a women's sport, and it has grown in the digital age, and because they can find each other and connect and share and sort of build a community, and that's how they organize their tournaments. One of my partners is the strength and conditioning coach for Team Canada. They're distributed across the country. They don't have a lot of resources, so everything's online. You know, he's tracking their sleep patterns, giving them challenges to say, hey, you guys aren't sleeping quite enough. You know, your average sleep time, 6.5 hours a night. Let's bring the whole team up to 7.5 hours a night.
Wow.
And now they're talking back and forth with each other and sort of critiquing each other, saying, hey, you're bringing our average down. You got to get more sleep.
Smart.
It's really just kind of what's your goal? Is it to promote a team? Is it to promote the elite athletes? Is it to increase recreation? Is it increase to people at the entry level of the sport? And that's where I see that technology is always a place that can make it easier to get involved, easier to, as I start running, as I watch teams of runners start running outside my house every morning, every single one of them starts an app. They're tracking themselves. They're comparing themselves against their friends. They're sharing at the end of the day, here's what I did. And the phone will remind them, hey, are you going to go for a run today? You thought it was a good time last week. And it's amazing how that tool is just making that sport change and become more interesting. And you can't really just fade off and say, well, yeah, I ran last week. Maybe I won't, because everybody knows.
But, well, I do that all the time.
But in the olden days, not too far away, and again, and since some countries still, you're just going out for a run. You know, you got no shoes on. You're just going out for a run. You're feeling the passion of sport by, you know, kicking a ball, a makeshift ball in certain countries. And then we have this huge technological gap that's there. So how do we bridge that gap? Will we ever bridge it? Because at the end of the day, to me, it's about the passion of the athlete. You can have every gadget, every gizmo you want, but if you don't have that heart and passion, you will not be standing on any podium. I don't care. So have any of you seen that illustrated in the fact that we got to keep some of those traditional things versus being too gizmoed out?
I mean, wasn't it cycling that said, hey, to beat a certain world record, you need to use the same bike that was used to set the original record, you know, 100 years ago or something like that? I mean, because better bikes, people keep getting better, but it's not a human getting better. We talked about running and kind of the impact of the track, and almost the entire improvement in terms of time in a marathon can be ascribed to the track, right? The fact that you're running on a hard track, not a soft track. But when it comes to accessibility, I think that's one answer that's easy. I mean, technology is like Newton's law of entropy. It's inevitably making things more and more accessible. And I think before you could only watch a game if you got into a stadium. Then you had to tune into the radio. Then you could watch a television. Now you can be on your phone or on your podcast or you know, whatever.
So many choices. There's a lot of choices.
There's a lot of choices
out there.
And there's 7.4 billion mobile subscriptions, right? So the more and more people have access to this, to these kinds of experience.
I think it's only going to become more accessible. I mean, like you said, Facebook is only going to grow. Some people say we need to look at China, see what they're doing, because they've got some swamp monsters in their, you know, isolated little area. And what you see with China, with Weibo, is that everyone does, you know, people can do a lot of things in one app, and I see Facebook slowly building out different features, and they're slowly adding to that. Soon, everything's going to be accessible within that app. I mean, what they do in China is you can literally have a friend text you, do you want to go for dinner? You can go on into Weibo, see what the reviews are in a certain restaurant. You can check into that restaurant. Then you can pay for the restaurant at the restaurant through the app as well. I mean, this is the entire experience is completely fueled by technology there now. And I think Facebook, who knows where it will be in 10 years, and what will that be for sports?
That's right, yeah, open question.
But you have to think about the technology companies too. We do a lot of work in India. It takes 15.3 seconds to load a website in India. I don't know if you know that. And it's really expensive for the average Indian to actually buy mobile time. So Facebook invented Facebook Lite, which is a lighter version of their app. It loads in 1.3 seconds, and you don't need to have your data on to access it all the time. So I think I actually go in the opposite direction. I don't think about people in emerging markets that don't have access to technology. I think about how the technology companies are saying that we're going to expand our global mm-hmm. footprint
right.
so that those people can have access to our technology.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's a great way to put it. So we've got a few remaining minutes now. I just want to see if anybody has any questions they'd like to ask this esteemed panel while they're here. I see one right over there. Anybody have a question, comment? Okay, we have one over here. You could stand up, say your name, where you're from, please, and who you like to direct it to, if not everybody. Yeah. Yeah, because so we can record it forever.
Got your data.
Yeah, exactly.
Hi, my name is... Can you hear me? Yeah. My name is Robert from Genius Sports.
From what sports?
Genius Sports.
Genius Sports,
yeah,
okay.
Sports technology company.
Perfect.
One thing that I found a little bit contradicting with the presentation and the debate was the fact that Facebook is so popular because it's also a tool where people create their own content. And this is why people think that it will stay for a number of years. Whereas, on the other hand, you're also involved in a project like Dugout, where it's only audience receiving information but not really producing their own content. And from the perspective of federations, I think quite a lot of them, they would also want to create platforms where they can own the viewers again. However, at the same time, they have this kind of dilemma whether you know, to put the resources in order to do it and how to monetize on that and how to explain that from the revenue perspective. So I think we still are in between those two solutions because, yeah, as I said, when it comes to you know, creating and then owning...
I think it's a great point, but I would just throw one question back at you is where are that audience going to come from? Right? When you have a platform of 2 billion people, if you want to grow your audience, there's no better platform to lure people in than Facebook. Yeah. I absolutely agree with you. That's the philosophy with something like Dugout is we have to get fans somewhere. Where are they going to come from? Where's our audience going to come from? And I think if you ignore the power of Facebook and the reach of Facebook, you're shooting yourself in the foot and not growing the biggest possible audience you could have for your own content.
The best slide you had was the slide with showing the different content types in the different social media platforms, right? And essentially, if you're building your own app, just put your app in the middle there. Create Facebook-optimized content for Facebook, funnel the users to your app. Create Twitter-optimized content for Twitter. I guess maybe not Twitter. Funnel it to Twitter. Well, I'm actually a big fan of Twitter. I think there's, again, specific things that are best for specific platforms, right?
Exactly. Live events, live sports,
exactly.
100%.
And for different sports.
Now for different
we're
sports,
really
different
talking
communities.
About, like, there's just a lot of solutions now, and
lots
some sports need
yeah.
that easy way to organize at a right. grassroots level. Yeah. And apps or something may do that for them. Okay. Others are looking for a way to promote it at an international level.
That's right.
And so there's just, you have to choose what's right for
you.
Your goals.
Exactly.
It's all about the teasing.
Yeah.
Okay, we got two questions here. Let's go to this.
Teasing for the fans.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hello, I'm Jacob Udom from company TrackTrack. I'm curious about your view on wearables and when the sports are prepared to share those data collected from sensor of information, because in my world, there's a load of content to be gathered there, but in the sport, there's reluctance to share it, especially to share it in live competition.
Yeah.
Do you see a movement towards that happening, that the sport's being more prepared to share maximum heart rate values
yeah.
ever recorded for a specific athlete and all that stuff?
What's happening now?
I'm looking at Roham. Oh, I think this is your...
Well, I mean, I think it's happening. It's inevitable, yep. right? I think the main question there is who owns the data, right? And what if an athlete... You know, if you're measuring me and then you can fire me earlier because you discover some sort of heart arrhythmia or whatever, then I need to be compensated in some way for that. I think these are the really only open questions, but there's a huge drive. Fans want the data, teams want the data, coaches want the data, and frankly, athletes, I bet they're curious. They just don't want to be screwed over by giving up the data. So I think it's one of the urgent questions that needs to be addressed at ASAP.
I think we got one last question from. one of the leaders in sport marketing, Patrick there.
Patrick Nally from the International Federation of Poker, but sometimes rights developer with international federations. I'd like to ask the panel, because you talk about friend or foe, but isn't technology at a risk of killing international sports and international sports federations? Because they've so long been on exclusive rights to broadcasters, exclusive rights to sponsors. But if you look at Twitch and you look at how games and people are forming right. leagues, they're forming competition, they have the ability through technology to not bother with sports, and the young people are not bothering in many ways with sports because technology is giving them the things to select their own choice, to do the things that they want to do, as opposed to what international yeah. federations mm-hmm. would want them to do. And isn't there a grave risk that this could be the death knell to the international federation if they don't capture technology?
Who wants to tackle that one?
Wow, that's a big one. But
big one. So very briefly, let's just...
Society evolves as we talk about evolution. One of my personal viewpoints is that team sports are very valuable for building teamwork, and they work when your schedules align. And I can go, and I know everybody works 9 to 5, and I can drive the kid and drop them off on Saturday, and they're going to join the league. But as lifestyles change, especially as we have become more sedentary for most of our jobs, we're sitting at computers, on the weekend, I don't really want to go to a baseball game. It's not the kind of thing I'm looking for. I'm looking for my individual activity that works at my time. And I see skate parks as like the ultimate drop-in, because there's not a schedule, there's not a team requirement. So I see as our lifestyles evolve, our interest in different sports evolves. I think as there's spectators and fans continue to grow, community building, but what people actually participate in does change based on what their lifestyle is looking for.
I would answer that question in this way. The average person on social media follows 12 athletes, 6 teams in 1 league, right? And I look at, we work with the NBA in all 30 teams. The NBA to me has been a breath of fresh air in terms of how they view rights. Mm-hmm. They view that a rising tide raises all boats. They look at the league and the teams as being equally powerful and growing total audience. They believe in share the content, build the brand to make it as large as possible. And I think they've done a phenomenal job of becoming a global brand by being so open with sharing their content. And now they're kind of reaping the rewards by structuring great deals, not only across broadcast, but also across all of their social and digital audiences. So you're exactly right. Definitely a foe, but I think it can be a friend if you just embrace it in the right way, so that you are raising all the federations and all the leagues and teams.
One final note on this, or
I mean, I was just going to say, I don't think it's friend or foe. It's a double-edged sword, right? Like you can cut yourself with it, or you can cut someone else with it, but it's a sword. It's what it does. The fear isn't from technology; it's from the federation's reticence to adopt it, right? Like this is the opportunity to get your sport in front of billions of people who really care about it. Get your messages in front of people who really care about it. So being selfish with the content, or too cautious, I should say, not selfish, is that's the danger there.
A little bit on the friend. Keep making new friends. Try new things.
Make
but,
new friends.
You know, you don't. I've heard some people say, I've got enough friends. I don't need any new ones. But, you know, technology has potential to introduce you to new friends, but not all of them work right. out. Keep that's care true. Of your old ones. It'll be around for a lifetime, but maybe go out and try and meet some new ones. Yeah.
Well, that's a great way to wrap this up, Jay. Thank you all so much, Jay, Roham, Marielle, and certainly our keynote today, Craig. Thank you all. Great questions.